Hello friends, welcome back to NGuru. Today is the second day we are covering the syllabus of computer literacy for TGT, PGT librarians and for other posts in Kendriya Vidyalaya Sangatana. Yesterday we have seen something about the characteristics of the computer and basics of hardware and software, all other things. Today, we are going to look at some other topics which are given in the syllabus. Okay. The very first topic is computer hardware. Okay. We shall start the session. Computer hardware, yesterday also we have seen a little about hardware, and we understood the definition that anything that is visible, that can be seen with the naked eye, is considered as computer hardware. It has got some physical structure. Like we have seen the hardware like mouse, keyboard, all other things, right? Primarily, broadly speaking, computer hardware is broadly divided into three categories. Number one, input devices. Number two, output devices. And number three, storage devices. So yesterday we have seen the block diagram of the computer. There is something called input devices and output devices. Is it not? And CPU in between. This is what. So, we will be talking about input devices, output devices, and the storage devices in detail. This is the CPU. If you can recap from the extra day's session. These are all the components. Okay. Yeah, coming back to computer hardware, it has been broadly divided into input devices and output devices and storage devices. We'll see what exactly each one is. Input devices. So input devices allows a user to enter data and instructions into a computer. Usually, whenever you are working on a computer, your keyboard or your mouse is used to give instructions or data to the computer. Is it not? If you look at the input devices examples, we have mouse, we have keyboard, we have microphone, scanners, trackball, joystick, some of the tablets, a graphics tablet, it will take input from the user, digital cameras. You already know, I mean, you have already seen maximum components in the list, is it not? So if you look at the examples, so you know what is mouse, keyboard, all these are input devices. These are all examples for input devices. Microphone, scanner, joystick, digital cam, all these are input devices which you use in a day-to-day life. Then comes, what are the basic functions that all the input devices will be performing? The very most important function is like it accepts the data and instructions. So whatever that you are inputting, that means whatever, say for example you are typing RAJ Raj, for that matter 1 2 3 4, or any symbols that you want from the keyboard. The input device, because it is an input device, your keyboard, it accepts that data, right? At the same time, it also takes the instructions, like if you are working on Windows, so minimizing the window, maximizing the window, doing all such things, right? These instructions you will be giving to the system via your input devices. That is important. Via your input devices like your mouse and keyboard, right? Which you use. Converts the instructions and data from human readable form to the machine readable form. Even yesterday also we have talked about one example, like when you say ABC, right? When you say ABC, when you type ABC on the system, this is a human readable form, right? Only humans can understand ABC, but for a machine, we have already seen like it only can understand zeros and ones. So this has to be translated or has to be converted into machine readable form, right? Whatever input that you send, it will be accepted by the input devices and will be converted from the human readable form like RAJ, Raj, 10 plus 20, all that, right? Human readable form to the machine readable form like zeros and ones, the instructions and the data. Next, it supplies the converted instructions and data to the CPU for processing. So, CPU will read and write data from the memory, right? Converted instructions from the your input devices has got the capability to convert the instructions, and the same will be supplied to the CPU for processing. Because yesterday we have seen the model of IOP model. What is IOP model? Says input process IPC model. IPO model. So input, process and output. So input will be given to the system via input devices, and process means it has to process. Who is going to process in the case of computer? It is the central processing unit or the processor, which we are calling it as a brain of the computer. So the converted instructions from the input devices will be given to the CPU for the processing. Right. Then comes the output devices. Output devices are used to display the result or information to the user. So, once the processing has been done by the CPU, CPU is going to produce the same result for and will be given to the output devices, whatever output device that is connected to the system, right? So those things will be produced or displayed to the user. So those devices, some of the output devices, if you look at the examples for output devices, we have monitors, very frequently used, most frequently used monitors, you already know about it. The printers, in a physical format, you are going to get the result of the process. Plotters and the speakers. So speakers, when you watch a movie or when you listen to your music, so usually the output is coming from the speakers. Right, those are all also output devices. Yeah, if you look at the examples, monitor is one output device, printer, plotters, right, speakers, all these are some of the examples for output devices. So, what are the functions, basic functions of any output device that you are using in a computer system? It accepts the results produced by the computer. It accepts the results produced by the computer. That is, most important thing here is, in the form of machine readable form, what the computer will be producing. Computer will be producing zeros and ones, because computer only knows zeros and ones, right? It accepts in the form of zeros and ones. Finally, it is going to produce the results also in the machine readable form. But the output device will accept the same, will accept the same machine readable form. Converts the coded results into human readable form. That means, it converts the results, because it is in the human readable form. It is not in the human readable form, sorry. It is not in the human readable form, that is zeros and ones. It will be, the CPU has outputted in the form of, is given the result in the form of zeros and ones. And the output devices, the most important function, one of the most important functions of the output devices is to convert functions of the output devices, which it accepts, all the output devices accepts the results, converts the coded results into human readable form. That is, from zeros and ones, we are again going to get, from zeros and ones, we are again going to get whatever that we have inputted, like ABC, or Raj, or Sita, whatever it is, or Rahim, yeah. Supplies the converted results to the user. That is what on the monitor you are going to get, whatever that you have inputted, right, via your keyboard. I'm sorry, via your keyboard, right? So these are all some of the functions of all the output devices that we use in day-to-day life. Then comes the third part, storage devices. What are storage devices basically? Storage devices are used to store and retrieve data and information. Say for example, yesterday you went to college or you went to your organization, your workplace, and you met several people there. After, say for example, after 1 week or so, will you be able to remember exactly every minute of second that has happened just a week before? You cannot do that. But at least you can, your brain has got the capability to memorize certain things at least. In a similar fashion, storage devices are used to store and retrieve the information when required in the future. See, storing information means, yesterday also we have seen, the data is more valuable these days and we have to store it in a permanent storage, and you are going to look at the memory, types of memory in the next coming slides. For time being, storage devices, keep in mind that these storage devices will be used to store and retrieve the information whenever required. Look at the examples for storage devices: hard disks, hard drives, memory sticks, your pen drives, what they call, your compact disks, your versatile disks, tape drives. All these are some of the examples for storage devices. The same thing, we have a hard disk, we have the DVD RAM, right? Memory chips, and we have pen drives, all that, USB pen drives. So these are all some of the storage devices where we store information and retrieve whenever we need it, whenever a need arises for the same data. Computer needs memory to store our files and our instructions, our programs. All that will be stored somewhere. Whether it is temporarily stored or it is permanently stored, somehow we need a way to store our data and instructions. So memory, our computer memory will give us facility to store the data and instructions so that it can be retrieved in near future. So memory usually used synonymously with the primary storage or main memory. When you say memory, we are really talking about the main memory or the primary memory. So how many different types of memory is available, broadly classified into two types, primary memory and secondary memory. So primary memory, again we have two different types, one is RAM and another one is ROM. So RAM is something but nothing but random access memory. ROM is something read-only memory. And we have secondary memory storage devices also. Just 3 or 4 slides before, we have seen the storage devices. So storage devices, they are all comes under your secondary memory only. So we will see what is primary memory and what is secondary memory in detail now. So before jumping into the types of the memory, before jumping into primary memory and secondary memory, we need to know, we need to understand how the computer data is stored and what is the basic unit to store the data in the computer. Previously, we were discussing everything the computer understands and stores in the form of zeros and ones. The same thing. So it uses the computer uses the binary number system. So binary, where we have only 2 digits. When it comes to decimal, as you know, like we have 10 different numbers there from 0 to 9, right? In a similar fashion, in the binary number system, we have only 0 and 1. A single bit, a single numeric value, either it is 0 or 1, we call it as a bit, B-I-T, bit. It's an important bit also for the competitive examinations. Several times the same question has been repeated in the examinations, right? So a single numeric value is called as a bit. Then there is another important thing called a byte. So what is a byte? It's a sequence of bits, what you can say. Usually it is a sequence of 8 bits. There are cases where a byte can be represented with a 16 bit, 32 bit or 64 bit, right? Usually it is of type, it is of 8 bits. 8 bits, each byte is considered as 8 bit. This is also a bit, a question that has been asked repeatedly in the competitive examinations. So if you look at the memory hierarchy, the units of the memory, there is something called bit. Just now we have seen there is something called bit. Okay. Bit is what? Bit is a single individual digit, either it is 0 or it is 1. In a similar fashion, we have a nibble where we have 4 bits like this. 1, 2, 3, 4. So, if you take all the 4 bits, it will be considered as a nibble. If it has got 8 bits, just now we have seen what is a byte, right? I am adding 4 more bits to it and it will be considered as a byte. So, because where we have 8 individual bits, right? It's a byte. It's a byte. Usually we are more interested in number of bytes a particular file or a particular object or a file occupies, right? Similarly, we have 1 kilobyte. Kilo means 1000, is it? So similarly, in computers, 1 kilobit is nothing but 1024 bytes. So this is what? 1024 bytes. Similarly, 1 megabyte is equal to 1024 kilobytes. 1024 kilobytes. So 1 gigabyte, we call it as 1 GB, right? So 1 GB is nothing but 1 gigabyte is equal to 1024 megabytes. 1 terabyte again. 1 terabyte is equal to 1024 gigabytes. GB, gigabytes. Usually our hard disks, hard drives represented in gigabytes only. Like 500 gigabyte GB of memory, 1 terabyte. These days we are talking about terabytes also, like 2 terabyte, 3, 4 terabyte, all that. Similarly, if you go beyond terabyte, we have got petabytes. So 1 petabyte is equal to 1024 terabytes. Similarly, hexabytes. So hexabyte, we have hexabyte as 1024 petabytes. We have zettabytes, all that also after exabyte, right? So this is the, this is how you are going to represent the memory when it comes to the storage devices, right? Already we have seen all the storage devices like hard disk, floppy disk. Floppy disk we have not seen. Actually, these days people are not using floppy disks. Okay. We have a USB drive. We have a CD-ROM. All that. Blu-ray, there is something called a Blu-ray disk, which has the capability of storing more than 25 gigabytes. We'll go for a, what you call, Blu-ray. It has got 2 layers. So almost, each layer, one layer can store up to, 10 to 14 hours of video. If it comes to 2 layers, more than 20 hours you can store as a video, right? So that is what we have with the units of memory. Now we'll jump into actual memory, right? We have seen a computer memory is broadly classified into primary as well as secondary, right? So now we'll talk about the primary memory. So what is primary memory? It is a very essential component of any computer system. So without it, there won't be any system. If I say there won't be any system without primary memory, it is true. Because there will not be any, almost, there will not be any system with without primary memory. So it is very essential that you need to have in a computer system. So what is the main thing that it is going to store? So all the data and the programs will first be loaded into primary memory. So to come into use, all your data and programs have to be in the primary memory. Unless until it is in the primary memory, your CPU will not be able to run anything. That's what CPU interacts. CPU directly interacts with the primary memory only, right? Whatever data that it wants to read, it will be reading from the primary memory only. And it will keep all the instructions. It will read them. If it has to write, that means the CPU, if it wants to write also, it will be basically be writing onto the primary memory, right? We usually call it as a RAM, random access memory, right? So primarily, your primary memory is, again, we have already seen in the slide, it is divided, primarily classified into two types. One is a random access memory, RAM, RAM, that is what we call it as, random access memory. Everybody is aware of RAM, is it? So random access memory. The other type is read-only memory. We will see about these two things, right? In the syllabus for Kendriya Vidyalaya Sangatana, they have specifically mentioned a topic for random access memory as well as for read-only memory. So we will look at these two things in detail. So these are a little important for the examination point of view, right? So random access memory, so it is also called as main memory. When you say primary memory or RAM, it is nothing but your main memory that we are talking about. So random access memory is also called as main memory or primary memory. It is volatile, the most important thing. It is volatile. What is volatile? So volatile means the contents will be erased, will go when you switch off your computer. That is what. That means which is not permanent is something called as volatile. See, the data and the instructions or the program instructions, whichever kept in random access memory, that means in the RAM, will be erased and will not be there once you switch off your computer. This is more important, right? That is something called volatile, right? Many number of times a question has been asked whether a RAM is a volatile or non-volatile, right? So just keep in mind that stores data and program temporarily. That is what I am telling. So just now we see like it will be stored. Volatile means so which will change actually, which will not be permanent. That is what we are talking about, right? It stores the data and programs, but temporarily, not permanently. Just now we have seen in the primary memory slide also, CPU directly interacts with the primary memory. That means it interacts, the CPU directly interacts with the random access memory, but the contents will be stored temporarily. Loads the program, that is what. So loads the program means, say for example, you want to use your notepad, or you want to use your Word, you want to use your PowerPoint, whatever it is. So the very first thing is, the system will, the program has to be there in the RAM to run on the CPU. So that means it will load the program. That means here in our case, MS Word or Notepad or PowerPoint. It has to be loaded into the RAM so that it will execute the, the instructions related to that particular software. So it loads basically the, all the programs will be loaded into RAM in the first place, so as to be used by the CPU. So random access memory, if you look at random access memory, it is broadly, again it is broadly again classified into two different types, broadly speaking, right? So there is something called static random access memory, that means SRAM. There is something called dynamic random access memory. So again, these two, these two are also important when it comes to the examination, because you might get a question saying what is SRAM, what is DRAM, or expand SRAM, expand DRAM, right? There might be a question on this SRAM as well as in the DRAM. So SRAM is nothing but static random access memory. DRAM nothing but dynamic random access memory. When it comes to static and dynamic, so the major difference is, like, static random access memory is faster than dynamic random access memory. It is fast. So SRAM is fast. You may get a question on this, like, which is faster. And it takes low power supply, low power, that means, than the, when compared to DRAM, right? It is faster, that means SRAM, what I am saying, SRAM is faster, and it takes, it consumes very less energy, that means your power, what I am saying, so, than the random access memory. So next comes the read-only memory. So these two, again I'm telling, RAM as well as ROM, both are permanent, both are primary memories only. Random access memory and read-only memory. We'll talk about, the very first feature of ROM, that is what? Non-volatile. Non-volatile, just in contrast, if you get a question like which memory is volatile or non-volatile, whether it is RAM, ROM, or SRAM, DRAM, something of that sort, you should say read-only memory is non-volatile. That means the instructions are stored permanently in the RAM, in the ROM, read-only memory. Whereas in the case of RAM, it is volatile, means the instructions and data will reside there temporarily, not on a permanent basis. In non-volatile ROM, right, the instructions will be stored permanently. So if you take an example for read-only memory, when you start your system, that is what we say, like booting. So your bootloader program is already there, in the instructions were already there in a read-only memory. That is what. So it is one of the examples for read-only memory. It is also called as a firmware because while industry, I mean, when you purchase a system, the manufacturer of that laptop or the PC, they are going to keep certain things, certain instructions in the ROM. So that is the reason why it is also called as firmware also, right? There might be a question for this also. So all these are very, very important for the examinations. Yeah. Okay. Again, as like random access memory, read-only memory is also broadly classified into two types. EEPROM, EEPROM. Again, these two were asked in the previous examinations, right? What is EEPROM? Erasable, programmable, read-only memory. Erasable, programmable, read-only memory. What is EEPROM? Electrically erasable, programmable, read-only memory, EEPROM. Electrically erasable, programmable, read-only memory. Just repeat these things. EEPROM is nothing but erasable, programmable, read-only memory. EEPROM is electrically erasable, programmable, read-only memory. If you look at these two terms, only thing is we have additionally electrically. Otherwise, these two are one and the same. So, what is the basic difference? So, the major difference is, so this erasable, what I am saying, this can be erased using ultraviolet rays, UV, you say, ultraviolet rays, right? But this EEPROM, this particular memory will be erased using electronic signals. So that is the only difference that we have. Otherwise, these two are almost one and the same. Okay? Read-only memory. Just keep in mind all these abbreviations and expansions, right? So that if you see them, try to memorize these things, or otherwise write it down somewhere so that you can repeat these things while before going to the exam, right? Again, see, whatever that we have seen till now is primary memory, is it not? So we have completed the primary memory now, right? Which is of two types, as I said, like random access memory and read-only memory. Again, to reiterate the things, random access memory broadly again classified into two types, right? Similarly, read-only memory is also classified into two types. Now comes the secondary memory. So what is secondary memory? You have seen the storage devices, right? Storage devices. Hard disk, floppy disk, all that. So those are all comes under your secondary memory. We'll see that. So what is secondary memory? It's a non-volatile memory. So that means the data and the programs will be stored permanently. Say for example, why we maintain a diary or why we maintain some notes? To memorize the things for use which may come arise in the future, right? That's what we write all the events, or we may write several events that are planned in the near future, like maybe in next day or tomorrow, even to-do list kind of thing, right? So in a similar fashion, computer also stores the information for future use, right? We have seen many examples like assessing the students' results, or just calculating the salary, gross salary and net salary of the employee, right? All these are stored permanently in something called as database management system, in a DBMS car, like things like you might have heard about Oracle, right? MySQL, Postgres, all these are some of the, right? And one more thing, whenever you write a letter, you write some notes on your Word, you are going to store that file in somewhere. Where is that somewhere? What is that somewhere? That is nothing but your secondary memory. So, to store anything permanently, you are going to, right, use the secondary memory. As I said, you have a primary memory which is volatile. The data will be lost once you switch off the computer. And we have seen there is something called ROM also. Read-only memory, where there are certain instructions which will be stored permanently on it, and it is not easy to erase also, right? Though it is non-volatile, it is not easy to erase. That is the reason why we have something called non-volatile memory, that is secondary memory, right? To store all your data and files permanently. So why, when we have, that is what, large storage capacity, you might think like, because read-only memory, ROM, ROM is also a non-volatile memory, why can't we store the files and all other things? You may get a doubt. No, it is very small, it is one thing. Second thing is, it is not, it is not meant for erasing things, right? All that. So those things will be, it's something called factory settings, will be kept in a read-only memory. That is the reason why we use the secondary memories, which can store, data in terabytes, hexabytes, all that. Such a huge volume of data will not be stored, cannot be stored in a, using your primary memory, either it is RAM or ROM. Because RAM is temporary and ROM, though it is permanent, it is not easily erasable. That is one thing. And moreover, these two, primary memory, these two, RAM as well as ROM, are very small in size. That's very small in terms of storage capacity. So maximum like 32-bit RAM, 64-bit, 256 RAM, 520, right? 516 RAM, all that we'll be talking about. So very, very less, not even one entire, a video of size 40 GB or 50 GB will not be stored. Not even that. Even if it is stored, it's not permanent when it comes to RAM. And when it comes to ROM, it is not easily erasable. Moreover, the capacity, the storage capacity is very limited. Okay? Then comes slower. What is that slower? Secondary storage devices are slower than your primary memory. when it comes to the speed, your primary memory is faster than the secondary memory. So primary memory is more faster. It is also called as auxiliary memory. What is called as auxiliary memory? Your secondary memory is also called as auxiliary memory. It is a permanent memory. It can store huge volumes of data. It is a little slower when it compared to the primary memory, and it is also called as auxiliary memory. So, but these days, we have something called solid state drive, SSD we call it as. So maybe you may get a question also, like what is solid state drive? It is a little faster nowadays. When I say it is slower, your secondary memory, it is becoming faster when it comes to the solid state drive. In recent systems, people are using SSD at least to store the operating system, all the frequently used programs, right? Applications. So they are going to store. It is a little faster. Though the secondary memory is slower, this particular one is a little better than the other storage devices that we have seen so far. So these are the examples for the storage devices. We have already seen this particular thing, like we already know what is hard disk, what is DVD, right? Your memory. So your USB, all these are some of the storage devices. These are all comes under the category of secondary storage or secondary memory, secondary storage devices. So there is something called cache memory. See, so far we have seen primary memory, we have seen secondary memory. Then what is cache memory? So this is a cache memory, like it will be pronounced as cache memory, C-A-S-H, cache kind of. Cache memory or cache, something like that. So it is high speed memory. So these cache memories are more faster than when compared to the primary and as well as the secondary. So far we have seen primary memory is faster. Primary memory is faster when compared to secondary memory, right? So just keep in mind, cache memory is faster than your primary memory. So cache memory is faster than your primary memory, and obviously it will be faster than your secondary memory also. So what will be stored in a cache? The programs which are residing in the RAM, random access memory, just recall that any program, any data that will be used by the CPU will be stored in the RAM, is it not? In the RAM. So RAM might have got 100 different data items, say for example 100 different data items, of which the CPU is using 10 data items are very frequently used when compared to all other 90 data items or elements, whatever it is. You take anything, okay? data elements. So this 10 elements which are more frequently be used will be stored in a cache memory. Right? This 90 will definitely be there in a primary memory along with this 10. So this 10 means, so primary memory, that means your RAM will contain all the 100. There is no doubt. All the 100. But very frequently or most frequently used 10 elements will, there will be a copy of these 10 elements in the cache memory. That is most important. That is what is important here. So what is that frequently accessed means? These 10 elements were frequently accessed by your CPU. That is the reason we are keeping this 10 elements, not we actually. The system will keep this 10 elements into the cache memory, and definitely the primary memory contains all the 100 elements, as I said. So 10 elements will, there will be a copy of this 10 elements in the cache memory also, so that when CPU needs, when the processor needs this data, it will not go to the primary memory and it will fetch from the cache memory only instead of going to the primary memory. So it's an extension to main memory. That is what we just discussed. It's an extension to your main memory, which is closer to the CPU, right? So this is what you can see. The cache memory is here as a part of your CPU. This is more important. So several times this has been asked in the examinations. Just keep in mind. So it will be between the secondary storage and the CPU. It will be a part of your CPU. Yeah. So there is a RAM. So random access memory. This is also called as what you call primary memory. Your primary memory. So all the data and your instructions will temporarily be loaded into the primary memory or RAM. Okay. The CPU, whenever CPU needs that particular data or instructions or the programs, it will directly read from the RAM. Okay. Fine. As just if you take the same example just now, so in the RAM, we have got 100 elements, what I am saying. But among this 100, there are 10 elements which are very frequently used by the CPU. These 10 elements will be stored in a cache memory. And this is also cache, level 1 cache and level 2 cache. So maybe, right? So this 10 elements will be stored in a cache memory. It is definitely the size will be less than the RAM. Okay. But most frequently used data will be stored here. Your CPU can directly access, this data, which is residing in the cache memory. These 10 elements what I am talking about, right? There are three levels of cache memory, level 1, level 2 and level 3, right? This architecture is which was given by Von Neumann architecture. You will come to know Von Neumann architecture in the coming sessions when we talk about the computer organization in detail. So for time being, just keep in mind that cache memory is little in size when compared to RAM, but it is more faster because it is directly available. It will be residing as a part of CPU, right? And instead of going to RAM every time, all the frequently used data elements, data items will be kept in the cache memory. This is also a temporary memory. Keep in mind, this is also a temporary memory. You may get a question on this. It is also volatile, what I mean to say. Temporary, right? That's what. Okay, there is one more thing when it comes to the memory part of the computer. If you look at this, this entire thing is a CPU. So it is nothing but the block diagram of your computer. From day one, we are looking at this. There is an input device, there is an output device, memory, right? Memory is not the part of your CPU. This here, our interest is in looking at the resistor. So CPU, that means the processor will have number of resistors to store the data and instructions temporarily. So as we have seen the cache memory, it is also it is near to the CPU, not exactly the CPU. It is near to the CPU than the RAM. So because for the same reason, the data and the instructions that are frequently used to be stored there, so that the CPU will not hit the RAM before hitting the cache, right? So where the latency will be reduced, all that. But CPU, the processor will have certain things, resistors. Even cache memory is out of the CPU, right? Out of the processor. So processor itself will have resistors which are more faster when it comes to the access speed, right? These are more faster. These are, the capacity to store the instructions will be lesser when compared to all other memories so far, whatever that we have discussed. The memory to store, when it comes to storage capacity, it will be very lesser than the other things that we have discussed. But it is a part, as it is a part of your processor, these are very, very fast. And CPU will store very limited instructions, like there is something called a program counter register, all that, right? So it is very fast than your cache memory also. So far we have seen the cache memory is faster. It is more faster than the cache memory, right? This is the memory hierarchy. So just please try to observe the diagram. Most important thing, I am expecting a question definitely from this diagram. See, this way, if you look at this way, we have something called backup storage devices. There is something called hard drives. After that, what I am saying, right? After tapes, you have hard drives. We have flash memory or USB memory. We have random access memory, that is RAM, primary memory, what we just now discussed. Processor cache. So just now we have seen there will be a cache with a part of your processor, right? Again, there is something called your resistors. Just now we have seen the resistors also. It's a part of your, the resistors will be a part of your processor. Again, your cache is also a part of your resistor. Now, if you observe this way, the size of tape drive C is maximum. It is max, what I am saying. maximum, right? So you can store maximum, what I mean to say. Hard drives, it is again the other feature. One is storage capacity is more, and when it comes to the access speed, it is very slow. And when it comes to the price, one more important factor is price, the cost, what I'm saying, to purchase a tape drive for backups, it is affordable than what? Than hard drives. That means your hard disks, external or internal, whatever it is. So when compared to your tape drives, your hard drives are slow, right? They are very cheap. They are very cheap, right? And once you go to your USB memory, it is slower than hard drives, little cheaper. Then when it comes to the random access memory, it is fast than all the three and affordable. Fine. When it comes to cache memory is very, very fast and very expensive when compared to your random access memory. And registers are very, very fast and very expensive. That means this memory hierarchy shows this as most expensive and very fast. And these are less expensive and very slow when compared to all other things. In between, all these falls under in between. Fine. When it comes to size and the capacity, just now we have seen resistors, they are expensive, they are very fast, but it can store very small amount of data. The capacity is to store the data and instructions will be limited. Very small in size. And cache memory also same thing, right? And RAM can store medium kind, like it can store more than what the resistors and cache memory can store. And here cache memory can store more than what the resistors can store. Similarly, your random access memory RAM can store more than what a cache memory can store, and the capacity is also more, right? Similarly, the same thing with the USBs, and same thing with the hard drives, and same thing with the tape drives, which will be used for your backup. So thank you so much. We will meet tomorrow with one more important session. Thank you so much.